Hi, I'm Rod Gerardo, research resident at Cincinnati Children's Hospital Medical Center. And a few weeks ago, we talked about esophageal atresia and tracheoesophageal fistula. We talked about the diagnosis and surgical management, but one piece of the puzzle that we didn't get to touch on. What happens when that space between the proximal and distal esophagus is just too long, or what we call a long gap? So today, we're gonna talk about long gap esophageal atresia with Dr. Dan von Allmen. He's the surgeon in chief at Cincinnati Children's Hospital Medical Center. And the first thing we should probably touch on is, how do you even know if that gap is too long in the first place?
Our method here is that if we have a child with no gas in the abdomen and we take them to the OR and put a G-tube in, many times we'll put something up the distal esophagus at that point and just get a fluoro shot. But then would wait a couple of weeks, and we have our patients go down to interventional radiology where we have a protocol for measuring the gap.
Okay, so at Cincinnati Children's, they have a protocol for how exactly they measure that gap, so it's the same for every patient. So then once you find out that you have a gap, you got some options.
They all have advantages and disadvantages. As we all know, we like to try to preserve the esophagus if we can, and certainly John Foker and David, who's been on, and Kimura have described great elongation techniques that can be used to try to preserve the native esophagus and get the two ends together.
First, let's talk about the Foker technique. In this procedure, the surgeon, through an open incision, will tie a suture to either end of the esophagus. Then they'll bring those sutures out through the chest wall and close the incision. Then they take those two free ends of the suture and tie them together in a knot. Then they place spacers underneath the knot periodically, about every day or so, until the two ends come together and they take the patient back to the operating room for a primary anastomosis.
The physiology, which I believe in intensely, is that stretch is a very strong promoter of growth. And that if you put things on tension, they will actually grow over time. That's how the cardiovascular system develops in utero. And I did some research early in my career looking at lung growth and using pressure to grow lungs. But the philosophy here is that with traction, you can get the two ends of the esophagus to grow. And if you can get them to grow far enough, you can put them together.
Okay, next we'll talk about the Van der Zee technique. It's the same concept, except it's done thoracoscopically, and there are no external sutures. So all of the tension is inside the thorax.
And lastly, the Kimura technique, which really isn't used all that often anymore. The idea here is you first create a spit fistula, and then periodically you move that fistula down the chest wall over time to stretch the proximal pouch, bringing it closer to the distal pouch to be able to create an anastomosis.
Now, if we look specifically at the Foker technique, there is some good literature to support this technique. Here's Dr. von Allmen.
There was a great article published by the Boston Group, 2015, divides the cases into two groups, a primary group and a secondary group, secondary being patients who had had operations previously, and the primary group being cases that they saw de novo. Obviously, you look at the result of getting the esophagus together, an intact esophagus in 96% of patients in the primary group, about two-thirds of patients in the secondary group. But these procedures are not without some morbidity, and you look at the ICU stay is a median of 70 days with a couple of weeks being paralyzed for the primary group and 110 days for the secondary group with a month of being paralyzed. About two-thirds of patients with the primary repair were able to get the full oral nutrition, and about 10% of the patients who had the secondary repair.
If you want the article, I'm going to link it below, so scroll down under the media player, you could open it up.
We were all taught the dictum that every effort should be made to conserve the native esophagus, as no other conduit can replace its function in transporting food from the oral cavity to the stomach satisfactorily.
So all of these techniques are great, but what if none of them really work? Then what do we do?
Great question, Rod. You could use the stomach. That would be called a gastric transposition.
The surgical group from the INOEA, their recommendation, the recommendation for the first option is a gastric pull-up. You divide the esophageal stump at the esophageal hiatus and mobilize the fundus and pull the fundus up, and you can pull it up either in the anterior or posterior mediastinum.
You can actually use the colon as an interposition as well.
I personally was trained to do colon interpositions.
And just how exactly does Dr. von Allmen do this colonic interposition? Well, to answer that, we have this awesome video created by the Cincinnati Children's Media Lab. And they were gracious enough to share this with you so that you can learn. So we're gonna start off with two incisions. First is your midline abdominal incision, and second is your cervical incision, because think about it, that's where we're gonna be doing these anastomoses. Now, once you gain access to the abdomen, like Dr. von Allmen said, the piece of colon that we choose is really based on the blood supply and the diameter that you're gonna need. Now, once you have that piece of colon you're gonna use for the interposition, Dr. von Allmen pulls that behind the stomach, maintaining the blood supply and obviously making sure that you don't make it too tortuous. The stapled ends of both the proximal esophagus and the, I guess now proximal colon part of the interposition are removed, and then we can do our proximal anastomosis, which is what you see here. And then the distal anastomosis, same thing, so remove the stapled end of the colon, create the gastrotomy, and we're gonna do our distal anastomosis similarly, as you can see here. Boom, there you have it. But we're not done. So next, to help with gastric emptying, we're gonna do a pyloroplasty, which is again depicted here. And then finally, we have to re-approximate the two blind ends of the colon that we took. So same thing, remove the stapled portion, and you're gonna do your colo-colo-anastomosis. And like with any other anastomosis, the key here is preserving the blood supply. Once that arterial supply is confirmed, then we know that we're in a good place to finish this surgery out. And now we're gonna show you the side-by-side comparison. On the left, the long gap esophageal atresia, on the right, the colon interposition. So thank you again to the Cincinnati Children's Media Lab. Scroll down under the media player. We're gonna link some more videos that they've made.
Now, the downside to using colon?
Common problems with this are that they dilate and they can become tortuous. It's not uncommon to get kind of a sigmoid sink drain deformity just above the diaphragm.
All right, Dr. von Allmen, how do you avoid that?
I was taught initially that you can't fix that and that it's too dangerous and that you'll risk the blood supply to the colon interposition. But I found that actually that's not really true. I pass the interposition posterior to the stomach, which leaves the vascular pedicle along the spine. And you can mobilize the colon. You can divide the gastric, do a laparotomy, divide the colon attachment to the stomach, and then mobilize the that sigmoid redundancy transhiatally, and then re-anastomose the colon to the stomach. So I wouldn't pretend to say that these don't need to be revised sometimes, but it is not impossible to revise them, and the kids tend to do pretty well.
But the good thing about using the colon?
You can get extraordinary length on this, and Mike and I have done a few cases for kids who had disasters, multiple operations elsewhere, who had caustic injuries that were involved all the way up to the pharynx, where we had to do a lot of work just on the pharynx to get that open, and then literally sew the colon interposition to the pharynx and then down to the stomach, which is obviously tough to do with a gastric pull-up.
And then here are some images of a colonic conduit in the OR, as well as a contrast image. Now, keep in mind that this video is from a live webinar. So here's a question from the interactive audience.
Anas Shika brings up a great point. He says, you know, is this growth or stretch? Looking at the short interval between the time of traction and anastomosis, which is less than 5 days, is this stretching or growing? Because this will impact the results and likely reflects on the complications. Would love to hear the comments for the experts on that.
I don't think we know. We should do the studies to understand that. But I would say that this gets back to David Vanderzee's comment about go have a cup of coffee and come back and it'll be fine. Clearly, that's not growth, that's stretch. And yet there's very good physiologic data that tension is a growth promoter, not necessarily in the esophagus, but in other organs. So I think that it's an area ripe for a little more basic science.
So there you have it, a little advice from Dr. Dan von Allmen about what to do when you have esophageal atresia and the gap is just too long to put together right then and there. So if you like this episode, go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on social media, download the Stay Current Pediatric Surgery app. And until next time, remember, knowledge should be free.